RadioOrNot.com and SoFloRadio.com present The Nicole Sandler Show.
Truth to power, baby.
And now, here's Nicole.
Welcome to a Wednesday. It is only Wednesday. Man, this week is plodding along, isn't it? Well, welcome to it. Nicole Sandler here, RadioOrNot.com, SoFloRadio.com, TalkRadio1.com, and ProgressiveBlendRadio.com. We are firing, I believe, on all cylinders this morning. If you tuned in early for the pre-show music, I know it ran a little over today. You might notice a change in attitude. Yes, I am getting on the optimism bandwagon. Yeah, you know, you gotta. I can sit and what is it called? Being in my cups? I never got that one. But, you know, you can either have a defeatist attitude and say the world sucks and everything is going to hell. Or you can say, all right, there are better days ahead. And I gotta say, the last few days have really restored my faith in mankind, honestly. For those of you who don't know, who aren't on my mailing list or haven't checked, you know, don't follow me on Twitter or Facebook, where the hell are you? I put out a plea on Sunday. I built a website called helpmehelpmydaughter.wordpress.com. And in it, I told the story of, you know, and regular listeners know the story of Allison and her struggles, her ADHD. And, you know, according to Allison, she has really, really, really been trying. It's hard to tell with her, but she has been trying. And here we are, 9 school days left. Again, they're off Friday, they're off Monday, you know, so the last day of school is June 8th. They have a half day, and that's it. And she is running against the clock, and it's looking like at this point she may have to repeat 7th grade. You know, and it's funny. The response that I've gotten from people has been, for the most part, really, really positive. People are saying, you know, I know how hard it is to ask for help. You did the right thing. You're standing up for your daughter. This is really good. A few people, you know, have sort of excoriated me, have told me that, one, I shouldn't have gone public with it. It's the wrong thing to do. Or that she's on the wrong medication. I'm telling you, the naysayers are the minority. Most people have been very helpful. And some of the stories that I've gotten from people are those who have relayed their stories, either their own personal battles with ADHD and their or their kids, you know, dealing with a child who's going through the same exact things that I describe. So, you know, yes, to answer a question in the chat room, they can retain her in 7th grade without my consent. I mean, she's failing. So, you know, she's convinced, you know, my kid is a tough cookie, and she's convinced that she will be promoted. However, if she's able to pull up her grades in 2 of the classes, there's 3 that she's failing, and then she's going to have to take on additional work in the 8th grade to make up the class that she failed in 7th. So regardless of whether or not she squeaks through and makes it to 8th grade, which I think socially would be better for her and for self-esteem reasons would be better for her, it's going to be, you know, the battle is going to be even more difficult, which is the reason why I want to get her into this program. And if you haven't read about it, let me just take a few minutes to tell you about it. I've got the brochure here. It's via Florida International University and their Center for Children and Families, and it's called the Summer Treatment Program. And, you know, right there, it says state-of-the-art treatment for children and adolescents with attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. And, I mean, it just... I really think this will give her and me the help that that we both need. Her to learn how to do school, right? And me to learn how to help her. Because right now, oh, I got to plug in my phone. Sorry about that. Because right now, it's a struggle. It's a battle royal every day because she does have this defiant thing going on that she's had really since she's had, since she started talking. One of her very first words was no. There was one time we were living in Los Angeles and I was listening outside her bedroom and she's in her crib. Who was ringing the doorbell? I don't know. Oh, well, David is going to have to wake up. So there was a, listening outside of her door. She's in her crib, chattering to herself and having an argument. And the argument consisted of one word. No, 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 no. Now, I'm wondering if she, picked that up from me, probably. She's always been, in fact, one of the first parenting books I bought after the books I bought to be prepared to bring home a child via adoption was called Your Defiant Child, because she has always been defiant. So now when you got a kid dealing with the hormones, right, seventh grade, just turned 13, dealing with all the social issues, right, the last thing that, she wants is the embarrassment of being left behind, left back, if as it were. Anyway, the point I'm getting to and the reason why I'm so optimistic now is I put up this website on Sunday and the response immediately was overwhelming. And then I sent out an email yesterday. Of course, I fucked up the email because the PayPal link was wrong. But I gotta say, I have heard from people, both strangers, people that I've never met in person, but who have, known my work over the years and have written such moving, touching notes, commending me for taking this step that is very difficult. And then people that I've worked with over the years, I mean, some, I'm going to cry here a second, some who I haven't spoken with or heard from in a decade, who have come forth with amazing generosity. And so I got to say, I think we're going to pull this off. I mean, I've got about $1,000 put away that I was planning on using for summer camp that I will use for this. And we're getting close. The thing I want to say to, especially the people in the chat room, if you can't afford it, if you're struggling right now, please don't send me any money. If you can't afford it, and there are plenty of people out there who can. Look, while you and I are struggling, there are still many, many people in this world who are doing well. So, if you can afford it, great. I so appreciate your help. Help me, help my daughter. .wordpress.com is the website. And if you can't, just spread the word. All right. I'm hoping by this time next week that I'm going to be able to take the website down because hopefully we'll have enough money to do this thing. Anyway, it has restored my faith in humanity. It has given me a bit of an optimistic outlook. And so I have pledged to myself that I'm going to try to be more positive. Instead of thinking with a defeatist attitude, I'm going to think, that mankind as a whole is good and that people do want to help one another. Putting Republicans aside. Anyway, I just wanted to start off the show with that and a thank you to everyone who's been so supportive. Really, you have restored my faith in humanity. All right. What else is going on? This show, we're going to be featured in Boca Raton magazine. It's a, it's a local regional magazine here in South Florida. After the show today, a photographer is coming by to photograph my mess of a studio here. So got to get ready for that. All right. Let me tell you what's on the show today. The second PayPal link on the second email didn't work either. But the link on the Allison page did. Yes, I know. See, I sent out another email. I sent out two emails yesterday. The first one, the link didn't work. And then I sent out a correction, which I thought had a working link, and it didn't. Oh my God, maybe I'm the one who needs a summer school. Anyway, but if you follow the link to help me help my daughter, .wordpress.com, it does work. Okay. Anyway, coming up on the show today in the second hour, we're going to be joined by Russ Baker of whowhatwhy.com. His website does a lot of really, really great work. And did I just close that window? Hold on. Let me bring it up because, he challenges things here. He and his staff challenge stories and ideas that don't. In fact, his latest posted yesterday, burying the, quote, Lockerbie bomber and the truth. Yeah, the Lockerbie bomber finally kicked. It's about fucking time, right? But is he the guy who was responsible? Russ Baker asks, was Libya really behind the atrocity, or was some other country or element involved? Right? And the story posted at whowhatwhy.com the day before, I spy an Occupy. Obama's DHS surveils legit protests. And it goes on and on. So Russ Baker, you know, who one of the great, the editor behind one of the great investigative journalism entities on the web, whowhatwhy.com, will join us in the second hour. This week, as you might have noticed, we've been starting, you know, in the first hour, talking with people involved in the movement, you know, the Occupy movement, the movement for change. And today, in just a few minutes, we'll speak with one of the probably more recognizable names from the Occupy Wall Street movement. We all got to know, well, I knew Jesse LaGreca years ago because, you know, I'm not big on Daily Kos, honestly. I don't spend a whole lot of time there. But somebody sent me a link to a piece that Jesse LaGreca wrote a few years ago. He blogs at Daily Kos as Ministry of Truth. And it was a couple of years ago during the president, or actually shortly after Obama won the presidency. And he wrote a piece, and I can't remember exactly what it's called. I'm going to find it. But it was basically, come on, just come out and say what you're thinking already. The president is a nih. You know, it goes back to the Blazing Saddles. The sheriff is a nih. Yeah. And I had been saying that on the air, and somebody sent me a link to Jesse's piece, and it's like, oh my God. So I had Jesse LaGreca on the show, and we've kept up a sort of a friendship. And then one day I see him, you know, his video, his interview with a Fox producer who, of course it didn't make it on the air, but he owned that guy, and it went viral. And Jesse all of a sudden is like the face of Occupy Wall Street. Well, you know, Jesse's one of those guys who remembers the people who knew him when. And so Jesse LaGreca will join us in just a few minutes to give us an update on what's happening with the Occupy movement. I mean, the Washington Post, I think yesterday, declared it dead. That's not true. And to see what Jesse's up to. All right, so stick around. We'll take a break and come back with Jesse LaGreca, also known as Ministry of Truth at Daily Kos, and we'll do that next. I'm Nicole Sandler. Thanks for listening. It's radio or not.
I'll tell you about a fight over feral chickens in a delightful Texas town today on Hightower Radio. Some people complain that their town has gone to the dogs, but Bastrop, Texas has gone to the chickens, and Bastropians are proud of it. Well, most Bastropians. While other cities might boast of their historic sites or cultural offerings, the good folks of this easygoing, free-spirited community have chosen to highlight a flock of feral chickens that has lived for years on, appropriately enough, Farm Street. No one owns these roosters, hens, and chicks. They take care of themselves, eating bugs, clucking contentedly from yard to yard, and yes, crossing the road for no apparent reason. It's a quirky phenomena that fits right in with this town of delightfully quirky folks. 3 years ago, some of them got the city council to enshrine the quirkiness by designating their area the Farm Street Historical Chicken Sanctuary, a proclamation that provides protected status for the flock. Everyone smiled, the chickens clucked, and all was well. Until this spring, when Beverly Hoskins raised a ruckus in the hen house, figuratively speaking. As owner of several rental houses along Farm Street, she wants the council to consider repealing the proclamation, complaining that, quote, a lot of chicken waste was being spread by the daily promenade. The denizens of Farm Street, however, flocked to defend the fowls, asserting that wild chickens are an integral part of, quote, Bastrop culture. One lady who rents one of Hoskins' houses said of the chickens that roost in a tree in her yard, I welcome them. Another neighbor pointed out that, hey, the chickens were here first, and it is Farm Street. This is Jim Hightower saying, the fate of the flock is still up in the air, but the council recently hinted at its sentiments by authorizing some banners to be placed on Farm Street, telling motorists to slow down because they're driving through a chicken sanctuary.
Need an antidote to the progressive blues? Want some good news about how grassroots folks are rebelling against the corporate powers and winning? Well, here's an easy-to-swallow pill for you, the Hightower Lowdown. Hightower's monthly newsletter will give you the lowdown, even as it lifts you up. It's 4 pages a month, jam-packed with facts you can use, actions you can take, and Jim's own Texas humor, all for only $15 a year. To become a lowdowner, go to HightowerLowdown.org.
This is Joyce Kaufman, and I don't care. Because when I need to relax and scratch my scacus with a hairbrush, I listen to the Nicole Sandler Show.
God, I wish you wouldn't do me any favors. My goodness. All right, before we call Jesse LaGreca, I want to share with you, you know, yesterday on the show, I tried to call the DNC. When that didn't work, remember, I tried to call the DNC and there was no answer. So when that didn't work, I was either probably during a break, I sent an email. I sent it via their website, so I don't have a copy of the email I sent. But I said something to the effect of, you guys need to get off your asses and help, win the recall election against Scott Walker. Because if you don't, we're screwed. And I'll tell you this further. I'm a Democrat. If you don't step up and help, I shall, re-register as an independent or even a Green. I said that. So here's the response I got via email yesterday. Nicole, thank you for contacting us with your concern. The Obama campaign and the DNC are fully committed to helping Mayor Barrett win next month's recall election in Wisconsin, which will be an important victory for working families across the Badger State. Governor Walker has turned his back on the middle class and on Wisconsin workers, wholly embracing Mitt Romney's failed economic philosophy, one which says that if we provide even more tax breaks and giveaways to the wealthiest few, paid for by slashing critical investments in healthcare, education, and job creation for hardworking Americans, then everyone will be better off. It's the same tried and failed approach that has allowed Walker's millionaire and billionaire backers, like the Koch brothers, to keep doing phenomenally well while leaving the middle class in the lurch. Here's the good part. Ready? DNC Chair Debbie Wasserman Schultz has spoken to Mayor Barrett and has pledged the DNC's support for his successful election next month. Wow, that's mighty big of her, huh? She will host a fundraiser for Mayor Barrett later this month, and the DNC will utilize both its substantial network of activists, volunteers, and supporters and extensive online resources to assist in building the ground game that will win on Election Day. You notice what's missing from there. How about millions of dollars in reserve? How about even a few hundred thousand dollars? That's left out. But she continues, in addition, we will continue to work with the Wisconsin Democratic Party and the Barrett campaign to determine how we can be a key partner in taking back the governor's office for Wisconsin Democrats and giving middle-class families across the state a much-needed fresh start. Signed, Cheryl Green, Democratic National Committee. I'll tell you how you can help, Cheryl. Give them money so they can counter the millions and millions and millions of dollars being spent by the Koch brothers and Republicans nationally. Not a dime. Yeah. So, Axelrod said on Matto last night they gave them $1 million. I'll have to go look for that because I don't see any evidence of that. Yeah. So, I'm going to do some searching. But in the meantime, let's get Jesse LaGreca on the line, shall we? Of course, as I said before, Jesse is, he's like you and me. He's a guy who just got fucking fed up with it all and, had been blogging at Daily Coast and lives in New York and got involved with Occupy Wall Street. And he happened to be in the right place at the right time one day at Zuccotti Park when Fox sent their cameras, to try to, make fun of people. And but they got Jesse LaGreca.
Hello.
Hey, Jesse. Nicole Sandler calling.
Hey, how you doing?
I'm great. How are you?
Doing good.
Good.
You hear me well?
I hear you just fine. I got to say, first of all, what a difference a year makes. And I'm so excited I'm going to see you at Netroots Nation this year. You won one of the Democracy for America scholarships.
Yeah, I know. It's a total blast. I had applied maybe like 2 years ago and wasn't as well known. But it's my first time going, so I hope everyone will be gentle.
Oh, we will. And you know what? This will be my third time, so I feel like a real veteran. And we're going to be broadcasting live from there on Thursday and Friday. And so we're going to be set up right in the big exhibit hall. So please find us and come and sit down and chat. I can't wait to see you there. I'm so happy you joined me today. And as I was explaining that, you know, I was a fan of yours before the world got to know you from your blogging at Daily Coast as Ministry of Truth. And we first met via phone, anyway, shortly after President Obama was elected. And you put in black and white on you know, for all the world to read what so many of us were thinking, but fewer were willing to say publicly. And that is the you know, call, boy, what a, you know, I don't, call a spade a spade. This was the problem, that Obama is a black man, and there were a lot of people out there who were sort of tiptoeing around it and wouldn't actually come out and say it, but that's, you know, that's the reason for so much of the hatred of him.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, what makes me laugh is that right now you have a situation where the Republican Party wants to pretend to be the adults in the room. They want to put forward Mitt Romney and say, ooh, look what a great businessman he is. See how much money he made?
Mm-hmm.
And their base doesn't want to talk about that. Their base really, really wants to talk about he's a Kenyan and Reverend Wright. And I think the Republican base gets frightened when they see more than two brown people standing next to each other.
Right.
I just don't think they can tell the difference. There's this thing about Obama. I just don't know what it is that they really don't like about him. And it's funny because his healthcare program kind of resembled theirs from the 90s, and his tax policy isn't too far away from really, you know, where Bush has ended up with the Republican Senate as it is today. But there's just one thing they don't like about him, and it's funny that nobody really wants to, you know, call him out for it.
You're right. And so you did. And that's when I first invited you on my show. And I've always appreciated what you have to say. And again, I think the world got to know you when you happened to be at Zuccotti Park when Fox sent their cameras to try to, I don't know, you know, to try to paint the occupiers, the activists involved in Occupy Wall Street as a bunch of miscreants and uneducated, dirty fucking hippies. And you stood up and really schooled one of their producers. Of course, the segment didn't make it on TV, but it went viral. And so now all of a sudden, Jesse LaGreca is one of the, you know, the best known faces of the Occupy Wall Street movement. So as such, Jesse, I got to ask you, the Washington Post, I believe yesterday, published a piece basically saying Occupy Wall Street is dead. How do you respond to that?
Oh, it's like the 12th time they've run that. So I've actually had to respond to that several times before.
Uh-huh.
I mean, over the last 6 months, we've been declared dead more times than, you know, like rock stars and stuff like that. So I just don't take it seriously anymore. We're still in the news. The thing is, they don't even want to talk about the public uprising of the peasantry in the streets. They just want to say, oh, this again? It's over. You know, it's exactly like the rich people who are drinking their champagne sneering down at us months back. I just get that feeling all over again.
Right. No, you're absolutely right. That video that so many of us have seen is the people were on the streets in Wall Street, and then there's a, you know, the few 1% up on a balcony drinking champagne, sort of looking down on them. What a great metaphor for what's going on in this country, not only this country, around the world, as we're seeing people take to the streets in country after country, you know, protesting against the austerity measures that are being, you know, implemented against them. And I do say against them. That's I chose those words carefully because austerity, you know, is an action against the people who need help the most.
Well, austerity is just shock doctrine, Friedmanite, free market economics with a new name. And it's hilarious when you really think of the idea behind austerity is that we should all make sacrifices. But for some reason, in every legislative debate, when we go to the budget table and we say, okay, who's going to take sacrifice on the rich side? Who's going to pay more taxes? And all of a sudden, it's Hitler.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden, it's socialism. There's no breathing space for any debate other than cut taxes for the rich or you're Hitler or you're a socialist.
Right.
There's no honest debate there whatsoever.
No, no.
And it kind of ties into Occupy. Because with us, there's no honest debate with us. It's just, oh, look what the, you know, angry, unwashed masses did this time. That must be over tomorrow, right?
Right. So, Jesse, let me ask you, what is the state of Occupy? I mean, the last I heard, there were some people once again sort of sleeping down on Wall Street, though not at Zuccotti Park, and then the police came in and shooed them away. What's going on there?
There's a whole bunch of different things going on now. After the last two big actions, which was really May Day and then just recently in NATO.
May 15th, right?
Yeah, so people get energized in a way that's not centralized, and therefore they kind of make their own decisions. They do as they see fit. So some people feel that their activism can be best expressed by, being in the streets. Some people feel like their activism is best expressed in other manners. But I think we can all universally say that the fact that just this basic right to protest is under attack, that flies in the face of the fact that we're an open society and a democracy. I mean, when dissent is not allowed, you're not really free, are you?
No. In fact, yesterday on the show, I was reading some of the various accounts of what went down in Chicago last weekend. I had Punk Boy in San Francisco on the show, who was there. He's heading back to San Francisco today. And, you know, lately, over the past couple of weeks, I've been lamenting the death of the First Amendment. And yesterday, after after reading some of what went on there, I actually took my little pocket constitution and ripped it up, because look, it's pretty much dead. At least the First Amendment is dead. We have in the National Defense Authorization Act that was passed the other day. We can talk in a minute about the lawsuit filed by Chris Hedges and others that was victorious. But there's a provision in there that allows our government to lie to us, to use state-sanctioned propaganda to tell us blatant lies. And, but, excuse me, that's not what this country is about.
Well, the funniest part of it, though, is that what they're trying to do is they're trying to nationalize propaganda, right?
Yes.
So we can't nationalize the banks because the free market's better at that. But apparently the free market isn't doing a good job enough distracting us from the important issues.
No.
People don't trust Fox because people don't trust the absolute garbage in the media. So now the government has to take over the lie to us. So the corporate media wasn't apparently doing that effectively enough.
No.
To me, it's astounding.
It is.
And it's a very bipartisan effort. The co-sponsor of that bill is a Democrat from Washington.
Yeah.
I don't remember his first name, but it probably rhymes with Coke. or at least that's who his donors sound like.
Yes.
But nevertheless, this is the part that to me is the most infuriating, is that whenever you get a really bad idea, you can always find a Democratic co-sponsor for it.
Right.
There's always some sold-out Democrat who's willing to work with the 40 thieves in the Senate, or 49 thieves, or however many you need to totally monkey wrench an entire democracy. There's always some sellout, and that just totally defeats me in so many ways.
No,
there's some idiot Democrat who is like, hey,
always.
You know what we need?
Well,
option for Fox News.
Right. Well, the thing is, Fox News already has a government sanction. Nobody's coming down on them for calling themselves a news channel and making shit up constantly. They don't report facts. They report their invented, whatever, and they're allowed to call themselves news. Excuse me, if we have, if we have too many regulations in this country, then why the hell isn't there a regulation saying you can't call yourselves news if you're not news? And now, through this bit of legislation, it's government-sanctioned propaganda. Why don't they just say, okay, Fox is now our state TV? Because that's where it seems we're going.
That's a frightening proposal.
Yeah, but they just legalized it.
It's mind-numbing.
Yeah, it really is.
You know what the problem with the war is? It's not that it's massively expensive and crippling our country. We're rebuilding bridges overseas and they're falling apart here. Our kids are dying. This is a waste of time and money. But the problem is that the public doesn't like it enough.
Yeah.
It's not the fact that you're smoking. It's the fact that the flavor isn't the right one for you. That's the major issue.
But you know what? Even that, look, we have this weird government that we have. And look, I understand it's a Democratic administration in charge right now. But going against public opinion, and it's really the Republicans, like the majority of Americans support marriage equality. The majority of Americans support legalizing marijuana. The majority of Americans support the Buffett rule. The majority of Americans think we should end those Bush tax cuts for the wealthiest Americans. But this, now we have the case of the Congress saying, don't worry about what you think. We know what's best for you. Actually, we know what's best for us. Right? Isn't that what's going on?
Well, I think what it really comes down to, and this is just on a political level, is that the Republicans are a voting bloc for the 1%. The banksters buy them and they rent the Democratic Party. They buy enough Democrats that they know they're always hedged on their bets so that they'll get the majorities they need to pass the legislation they want. So the big problem in so many ways is the Senate, just for a good example. If that is a bottleneck for anything that might actually reform the banking system or foreign campaign finance, that becomes a broken piece of democracy entirely. Our country doesn't work, and that works great for the banks. They love stagnation. They love stasis. They really enjoy this period where they're not sure if their taxes are going up, and boo-hoo. Yeah. They can just breathe the life, you know, they can lay siege war on the rest of us until they get their way.
No, you're absolutely right. So I'm looking at ministryoftruth.dailycoast.com. That's where you can find Jesse LaGreca's writing. And you wrote a piece on Monday in the wake of what happened in Chicago over the weekend. And the headline is, "We are all whistleblowers now." Isn't that true? And anybody, you say, if you protest, if you march, if you're an activist, if you blog, if you live stream video, if you tweet or take photos, if you use social media, if you just share the stuff, you are a whistleblower now. And guess what? This government has cracked down on whistleblowers. So, you know, when you're doing the right thing, you're calling out the inequities in our system, to put it very lightly. You're blowing the whistle on somebody who's behaving immorally and illegally and against the best interests of this nation, and yet you are the one who's the criminal?
Oh, certainly. I mean, the way the media frames anybody who objects at this point in a way that doesn't benefit the banksters and the war machine, those people are automatically the other. And you get put in a place where basically you're not given even the recognition of being patriotic as well, or being, you know, someone who's a decent member of society. You're automatically cast down. So to me, it's very similar to the terminology we see against Bradley Manning, or even the way the government behaves towards these people that do blow the whistle. If you're Thomas Drake and you say, hey, what the Bush administration did was a war crime, and I'm saying something about it, we can look forward and not prosecute the Bush war crimes, but the people who blow the whistle on the Bush war crimes, those are the bad guys. We can't have that. And to me, it's a sign of a closing society, not an open society. A closing society is one that criminalizes journalists, that, you know,
Yeah. Keeps
the people off the streets. Like, literally, the reason people are on the streets is because things are broken and they need being fixed. And if the politicians are only passing an agenda that benefits the wealthiest among us and the corporations that don't really have to play by the same national boundaries as the rest of us, yeah, people should be marching in the streets. And they are all over the world. And it proves the fact that the corporate media has utterly failed at their task of informing the people. It's for-profit propaganda, and it's just remarkable that the government can step into the propaganda business, but not the banking business, apparently.
Isn't it? It's absolutely stunning. Jesse LaGreca is on with us. So now, you live in New York. I'm guessing you live in one of the boroughs, because Manhattan is prohibitively expensive. So what is your relationship? I think one of the reasons why the corporate media can get away with saying things like, oh, Occupy Wall Street is dead, is because you don't have the encampments, the 24/7 presence of people in cities around the nation, because, of course, we've learned there was a concerted effort to break those up. We've learned that the Department of Homeland Security was involved via, you know, thanks to some intrepid real investigative journalists out there who did file Freedom of Information Act requests to get documents. My buddy Jason Leopold springs to mind. So where are you? Where is the organization? Is there like a loose organization nationally? Is it all local? Are we all working together on this?
It's basically internet-born. That's kind of the amazing part of it. Mm. That in so many ways, because of social media, because of the way that we are able to share information now, that the political landscape has entirely changed. And this is not just on the street activism level. This is all the way up to the top. Liars can't get away with it on the national or local level, but at the same time, citizens can communicate with each other. So even without the encampments, there's still a vast network mm-hmm. of people who are just friends who talk to each other, people who know each other, that follow themselves on Facebook, Twitter.
Right.
They meet up when they can, when it fits their schedules. And then you see this very grassroots movement all over the place without very centralized organization. And it makes me laugh that, you know, some people, when they say, like, well, it's modeled after anarchism, that word scares the hell out of some people, but it really kind of is. But I don't really look at it like anarchism. To me, it's like very, very simple local government.
Yeah.
And like local on a very micro-local scale. So there are so many different people involved in so many ways that I don't think my internets are bigger enough to keep track of them all.
Right.
But I am glad that at least I wish somebody on the job better than DHS was doing it.
Oh, my God. You know,
people are staying in touch and they care about these
good
issues.
I'm glad to hear it. You know, I had Mike Malloy on the show last week, and we got into a very deep discussion about something that is an ongoing discussion in my chat room every day during the show, something that weighs heavily on me. And look, we've got less than 6 months till the election, and I'm sure my mind will change probably hundreds of times during that time about what I'm going to do come election day. I live in Florida. In Florida right now, Mitt Romney is ahead in the polls. And Florida is a swing state that's really integral to whoever wins the election. I do not like the job that Barack Obama is doing. I say that with no trepidation at all. However, I also realize that the Supreme Court is at stake here, and it scares the shit out of me that Ruth Bader Ginsburg and another one on the left side of the court, I'm drawing a blank on his name, will be replaced by the next president. I wish Ruth Bader Ginsburg would retire today because she's 384 years old and not well. No, not Kennedy. Kennedy's the swing vote. So that Obama could replace her, and then it wouldn't be, you know, a generational crisis if Romney gets in, because I really think that's the difference in the two. It's who they're going to name to the Supreme Court. And look, Citizens United is only here because of this, the makeup of this court. And it is an activist court, activist to the right. So, you know, my ongoing battle inside is always, do I register a protest vote and vote for a Green Party, Jill Stein or Roseanne Barr or something? Or do I vote for Obama as a vote against Mitt Romney? And Mike Malloy said to me, basically, he has the same inner battle. And the thing he fights with is, eventually, we need change. And the question is, you know, he thinks that, and I'm obviously paraphrasing it, but that we might be better served just to get it over with already. And things are going to have to get even worse than they are now before they can get better. And maybe we need to, you know, have things get so bad that we do have millions of people take to the streets, because that's what it's going to take. Not hundreds of thousands like we have now, but millions of people going out, sitting down in the middle of the street and saying, we're not moving. I know, Jesse, you and I have talked about this before, and you also understand the need for an inside-outside strategy. We need to take to the streets, but we also need to work within our system, and we need to elect real progressives to office. Where are you on all of this right now?
You know, I could almost like sum it up by something that my buddy Shamar Thomas, if you remember the Marine pig fellow, Shamar, I've met him a couple times, and he said to me, you know, he goes into his community and he asks, what can we do in the next 30 days to make this better?
Right.
And that sounds at first like a very radical thing to say, like, all right, guys, 30 days, get some ops, we're getting to work. But it's actually really pragmatic. It's saying, what can we do in the very short term to make things better? Now, when you look at it like that, I really cannot digest the idea that things are going to have to get willfully worse for the people who are suffering the most before things can get better. I just mentally reject that entire notion. That, you know what, if people really learn their lesson, then we'll get it.
Right.
I don't think that's how this country works. I think the way this country works is that when we institute a national policy, it sticks for like a decade. And you don't even get the chance to fix that until the next thing comes along, until you get further down the road, and all of a sudden, you know, no one wants to fix the thing we broke. And that's the way our bridges work. That's the way our cash code works. That's the way our wars work. Every single thing that gets set in, the next president's like, oh, we can't look backwards. You know, I'm going to have my own thing. So to me, I look at the difference between Obama and Romney in a much different way than most people do. Because to me, I look at it like, if you hated George W. Bush, you're really, really not going to like Mitt Romney.
Right.
And I say that because some people would say Obama equals Bush. And I'm not going to deny that there isn't a direct continuation of many of these policies, but I look at Romney's like such a phenomenal step backwards. Like, this guy is literally going to blow the deficit through the roof, because Republicans don't care about deficits. They just use that as a bludgeon against Democratic presidents. Their party platforms coming out of states like Iowa and other states are flat out saying Medicare is done, Social Security is done, Medicaid is done, it's going to run out, we should look into privatizing it now. They're talking about taking people's rights away in a way that the most fevered imagination couldn't come up with about Obama, that they literally are like, yes, let's go to torture. Now, we can say something about maybe like the three guys in Chicago who are in solitary confinement right now because apparently they had a beer-making machine and, you know, DHS needed to, like, arrest someone to have the claims of terrorism in the streets. Those people are in solitary confinement right now. And you could say, well, Bush started, Obama's continuing it.
Yeah.
Okay, and that's a fair accomplishment. But the question is, okay, we know where Obama is on this stuff. We didn't really think, but I don't think anybody who voted for Bush was like, yeah, they were going to go torture people. I don't know what the hell Mitt Romney says, and I don't think Mitt Romney does either. And that kind of scares me a little bit. When a guy is that willing just to say whatever it takes, and he comes from the 1% of the 1%, and he's an out-of-touch rich guy, my big thing is I'm not really sure where to put my foot on this because it does infuriate me, but I look at it as though it would be a very tragic event if this country were to take a phenomenal turn backwards. And even if you want to make the argument that the Democrats are shock doctrine in second gear and the Republicans are shock doctrine in sixth gear and there really isn't much variation between those two, I think second gear gives us some time to really make a voice. Sixth gear just plummets us into second world status.
Well, that's what it is. Not second world, but third world. And we're almost there. Look, I lived in Taos, New Mexico for a little while, and it was stunning because Taos is the perfect... Like, it's this ecosystem. It is, I used to say to anybody, like, people, they said, how do you like it there? It's like, oh, my God, it's a third world country. You have the very, very rich and the very, very poor. You can't earn a living wage there because it's so expensive. Yeah. And the people who need to work for a living have to work to serve the very rich, and never shall the twain meet. And that's where we're headed. And I tend to agree with you. Look, I don't wish... Look, I've got a kid who's 13. If Romney gets in and all these... You know, Ayn Randian kind of austerity and every man, woman, and corporation for his or herself ideals get through, you know, her life is going to be even worse than it is now. And it ain't too great right now.
Another way to look at that is also, let's say that the Republicans pulled this election out. Isn't that kind of rewarding every single filibuster?
Yes.
Isn't that kind of rewarding every single... sabotage thing, every time they've taken an issue hostage and threatened to, like, screw up something for the working class and let their rich guys get more cash touch for caviar-covered limousines. Every time they have a hissy fit and pound their fist. If people... The problem is the Republican base is, frankly, they're batshit crazy, and they never miss an election. And the problem with everybody else is that we think about things, and we have doubts, and we kind of miss elections on a way higher rate than they do. Look at the whole matter with women's issues. Women vote their interests. Women, if it weren't for the 19th Amendment, Romney would be winning right now. Women know that they're being screwed with, and they don't like it. And I wish that people would vote their interests in that way more often than they do, because...
Well, because look,
it's exacerbating dealing with these people.
Look, let's bring up Florida again. The fact that Mitt Romney is now something like 6 points ahead of Obama in Florida is mind-boggling. Because if Mitt Romney and the Republicans have their way, Social Security will be cut, Medicare will be privatized. Look, for people like me, I'm 52. They would do away with it for people my age. Everything I've paid into my entire adult life. It is for naught, because when I turn 55, they want to give me a voucher for $8,000. $8,000 won't pay for my insurance today, you know, let alone when I'm 70. And that's what and Florida has a preponderance of elderly people here who just are not fucking paying attention. This is what's so mind-boggling. So how do we get them?
I would love to see, Occupy do stuff where we just, like, put up major signs. Just put signs up. I think that would be a good start. Like, put signs up so that people know basic facts. Like, by the way, Social Security isn't running out anytime soon. We can easily fix it by taxing the rich. I mean, there's so many things that we can do, and the nice thing is that there are so many people who are trying to do something to make it better. So that's...
And I think one of the problems, my problem with Occupy, and I think it's getting better because, obviously, May Day and May 15th saw these disparate groups come together. I saw Occupy working with the unions, which is not what I saw in December when I was in D.C. So there was some sort of change, it seems to me, within the movement where people said, yeah, you know, if we are going to be successful and create a real movement for change, we're going to have to be a little more big tent. We're going to have to accept that unions and we are on the same side. And like you, when you did this, you know, Occupy Congress, realize that we need to deal with the people who are elected and maybe even get some of us to run for office. Where are we on that? Do we have any? Look, in 2010, we saw things swing so far right because the teabaggers put up candidates. That's why I'm stuck with Alan West here. Do we have any Occupy activists running for office?
We actually do, and I think that the point you made just now does kind of express the fact that in many ways the Democratic Party has moved so far to the right, dragging on the heels of, you know, every time the Republican Party takes a big step, the Democrats move a little bit more right to kind of be bipartisan. It's left a lot of people disenfranchised. That being said, there's two sides to Occupy. I think when you're talking about a movement and you call yourself the 99%, we are the economic 99% of people who aren't benefiting from this economy, I think that tells you to be inclusive. It's very difficult for me to say, like, we're 99% of people, but we don't want to be co-opted by somebody who's already here. It's like, okay, well, we need to be friendly and play nice and work together to achieve the goals that we want to get. That being said, I'm glad to say that there are people being active in politics, engaging in what ways they can for their communities. Here in New York, there's a gentleman, George Martinez, who's running for, I think it's Nadia Velasquez's House seat in Brooklyn and Lower Manhattan.
Okay.
He got on the ballot, and he's challenging her based on the fact that she was very quiet while Bush was president, and she was very quiet. You know, these people don't challenge power, and we need to threaten their power, given the channels available to us, as well as the channels that we have to take on our own sometimes with being civilly disobedient in the streets and so forth. But George Martinez has an excellent campaign going, and I really think that he speaks to the real problems that people deal with in this community here in New York as well as across the country, as much as I've traveled and seen it. And I'm applauding people who are getting engaged. I think to say that we are the 99%, but you know what, the 69 million Obama voters from 08, I don't know about those guys. They're a little bit too establishment. That's insanity to me. We should open our arms to our friends and our brothers and sisters and neighbors and say, you know what, we're going to change the way things are done, and we're going to change it for the better for all of us, not just 1% or 99%, or 100% of us.
I couldn't agree with you more. So how do we do that? And there, that's, you know, that's the big question. That's the $64 zillion question.
Well, here's the question I'm going to ask in a little Socratic method. Uh-huh. And it's that when they told us hope and change, who decided it was enough to do just bitch and moan? And that if you want hope to happen, that means you need to, I'm stealing the president's terms, but given the election coming up, if you want hope to happen, get off your ass and do something about it. In whatever way that you can, and if that means getting registered to vote, finding out if there's early voting, I want to see everybody engaging in as much democracy as possible, because the alternative, what the Romney world and the Bush world is selling us, is less democracy.
Well,
that democracy shouldn't be in the marketplace. It shouldn't be, you know, in the voting booth for that matter. Just let the billionaires figure it out.
And Jesse LaGreca, I love that you're saying this because, again, I did this event in D.C. in December with some kids, and they were kids, from Occupy West Palm Beach, Occupy Palm Beach, and they were, how can I say, they were so anti-establishment, which is fine, but they were anti-system. They're thinking, well, what we want is this perfect world where we all live on communes and we all take care of one another, and I don't want a job. I don't want to work. We all support one another. And it's like, you know what? You also need a dose of reality.
I think a lot of people have an idealistic view of the world that they would like it to be.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, I have my dreams too, but at the same time, I think there's nothing that you can achieve without hard work. And I think right now in this stage of American history, we're kind of given a new task,
mm-hmm.
which is not only do you have to work your tail off to just survive and make the basic needs of living, which is getting starker for so many people, but you also have to have a second job, and it's called being a citizen.
Yeah.
And it means making yourself informed, being active within your community, because there is an alternative to citizens, and that's corporations. You know, that's why they call it Citizens United, because Corporations United sounds crappy. but it really is Corporations United. And, you know, God, my friend Lee Camp has this great language. So, like, you know, working class people need a plan.
Mm-hmm.
Rich people have a plan. I'm not going to steal his bit, but they have a plan. And it's not a good one for the rest of us. We should have a plan, too. We should organize. And therefore, I say more democracy. More voting, more activism.
I hear you.
Get involved.
And we love Lee Camp around here as well. He's been on the show many times. And I always play his moments of clarity here because they are. I mean, Lee, I'm sure Lee will be, I would think, I got to ask him, in Providence for Netroots Nation as well. This is why I know, you know, you're making sense, because there are people in the chat room who, you know, are saying, you know, you've been bought. You're part of the administration. You're being paid for it. And look, I know you, and I know that's as far from the truth as can be. What are you doing now? What do you do with your time on a daily basis?
I write a lot. Yeah. I get involved in a lot of different group organizations just through Occupy, people I know. So I try to stay in touch with what's going on within Occupy, as well as just my own writing, my own activism. I do some freelance writing here and there.
Good.
I'm blessed with some really good supporters over at DailyCoast.com.
That's
so
awesome.
Make sure that, you know, I have basic needs met. But the funny thing is, I'm a frugal person. I'm a very non-materialistic person.
Right.
So when people are like, he's bought and sold, I'm like, dude, I wear, like, jeans. And, like, you know, I'm not, like, Rahm Emanuel Jr. walking around sending people fish wrapped up in newspapers. If I were, I wouldn't be me. That's not who I am.
Right, exactly. Yes, and so...
If anything, I laugh. But, you know, we give... For some reason, we give people credence based on the clothing they wear. That's always a funny one.
Yeah. No, I hear you. I just had to say what they were saying because it makes me laugh, because I know you.
Oh, yeah.
Jesse LaGreca, I will see you in 2 weeks at Netroots Nation. Hope you'll come on from there, and we'll chat and hang out. And, you know, as we keep working, as you said, and this was my theme when I started this morning, is that, you know, nothing is easy. And anything worthwhile take some hard work. It's a lesson I try to tell my daughter too. And also, I'm supposed to from Tifosa send love from the chat too, because the majority of the people in there are thrilled with what you're doing and what you say. And thank you for, you know, we need more people like Jesse LaGreca. And look, and as we've learned from the government-sanctioned propaganda and the lack of coverage of the movement by the corporate media, it's time to embrace the alternative media, whether it's, you know, blogs and online radio shows and, you know, entities that are not owned by the giant corporations. It's a new era we're crossing over into, don't you think?
Oh, yeah. I mean, look at it like this. We are the smallest David versus the biggest Goliath ever. But, you know, I'm thinking of my friends out in Wisconsin. I'm hoping the recall effort against, you know, Errol Walker goes well.
Yep.
But, you know, there's a great Vince Lombardi quote, and it's, you know, nothing easy is worth a damn. So nobody told you that this was going to be easy.
Nope.
I think a lot of people elect their officials, and they think, oh, the job's done. Nope, the job just started. Now do something.
Job,
you know?
Just started.
Stop bitching and start a revolution.
Right, and I'll tell you, that's one thing. You're going to enjoy Netroots Nation, because in addition to all the, you know, getting together and seeing people and talking, there are these sessions, which many of them are going to be streamed this year for people who can't make it to Providence. They'll be live streamed on the interwebs. It's all about organizing. This is something that we can do better than the right. We may not have the money, but we do have the passion and the people power, and now we just have to harness it and all get on the same page.
Oh, absolutely. You know, I was just sitting down to write something for today, and the first title I was working with was Only an Idiot Would Try to Beat the Banks with Money. It's like trying to stop sunblock with Capri Sun. It just isn't going to happen. They're outnumbered. You know, you're not beating the fire with more fire. You're just not winning on that. We need to organize people. That's the only counterbalance to big money. And if we're ever going to overturn these Citizens United laws and these crazy corporatist, you know, ALEC legislation, we're going to have to get people engaged.
Absolutely.
And if that means making fun of the crazy person who doesn't know nothing because they watch Fox News, then that should be a tactic we employ as well.
Exactly. Jesse LaGreca, find him at, you can get all his writings at ministryoftruth.dailycoast.com. I will have a link on my blog at radioornot.com. There's other stuff I thought, you know, from some of your recent writings that I thought we'd talk about today. Your latest one that you posted yesterday, Iowa GOP proposes the batshit craziest party platform you've ever seen, stunning work of idiocy. And you're so right. And this is what's coming from the right. So I direct everyone there. Again, I'll have a link on my blog after the show, and people can go read your writing. And I will see you in in a couple of weeks. I can't wait.
Absolutely. Looking forward to it, Nicole.
Thank you so much, Jesse. Bye-bye. Wonderful Jesse LaGreca, Ministry of Truth from Daily Kos. And you know what? I wish everybody was as well-spoken as Jesse is. I think he's going to be tapped to, he's going to have a media career in some kind of alternate media, not corporate media. It's not going to be MSNBC. Maybe Current would hire Jesse LaGreca. Yeah. Stuck in a rut, I would feel that would be a guest that could adequately get my point of view across to Nicole. Who? Because Stuck in a Rut has been just a real naysayer. I'm looking to see who. Stuck in a Rut, who? Oh, Derek Jensen. I don't know who Derek Jensen is. Send me an email and and I'll check him out. Look, the way this show works is Ron says he can't get into the chat today. That's weird. He was there earlier. Ugh, I hate technical issues. You know the way the show works. Look, when I fill in for Randy Rhodes, and by the way, I will be in for her this Friday as we kick off the Memorial Day weekend. So this Friday afternoon, May 25th, I'm guest hosting the Randy Rhodes Show. On her show, I get to take calls and talk to people with any point of view possible, right? And I love doing that. On this show, because the majority of people, honestly, are not here right now. The majority of the people who listen to the show listen via the chat. I mean, listen via the podcast. And Ron 117, you're in the new chat room. You're in here. And Stuck in a Rut, I don't hate you. I just think you're young and you're sadly naive. Because there are, you know, that's what I think about Stuck in a Rut, who, you know, is like, I'm voting for Jill Stein. Well, great. You live in Vermont and you can. Right. But in Florida, I can't. I really can't. I cannot see casting a vote. Sorry, my dress is sort of awkward. Casting a vote that would, in essence, become, a vote for Mitt Romney. Because I fear where that will take us. But anyway, the way this show works is, I talk to people. I interview people because I ask questions. I like picking brains, right? You know, so I bring on people who can teach me something or whose viewpoint I think would be interesting to you guys, to the listeners. I love that Tom Hartman spars with right wingers. I don't do that because you know what? I don't want to hear them. Occasionally, I've got some friends who are Republicans, old friends. I don't have any new friends really that are Republicans. And, there's one guy I've toyed with having on who used to come on my show a bit. And I know him from, when I was in my early 20s living in New York and I produced a right wing talk show, Bob Grant, who's, you know, one of the predecessors to Fox. You know, he's as right as they come. And this guy's name is John LeBoulier. He was a congressman for one term in New York, and I guess he does a radio show for Fox. I don't know if it's online or what. And there's part, and he's, I hate to say he's sensible because I don't know any sensible Republicans these days, but I may have him on just to see where his head is because I know he can't be in favor of Mitt Romney. But anyway, for the most part, what I do is invite people on this show who I am really interested in hearing from. And so your suggestions for guests are always welcome. You know, sometimes it's tough to keep up with the booking. Nicole at NicoleSandler.com is my email address. Go to the new website, radioornot.com, and there's a contact form there, and you can email me through that. All right. Coming up in the next hour, we'll have Russ Baker. Now, Russ Baker is an independent investigative journalist. You know, I always lament the fact that that seems to be a dying breed. But there are some out there. You know, we have... thank God for the nation. God has nothing to do with it. Thank the nation for the nation. For people at, let's get the news and then we'll continue this. Now, oh boy, it's time to check in for the latest. For that, we turn to the Talk Radio News Service at talkradionews.com. Good morning. Who's on the line today?
Good morning. It is Justin today. How are you doing?
I'm doing well. How are you doing, Justin?
Not bad, not bad.
Good. What's happening in D.C.?
Well, yesterday evening, we saw the CBO release a new report saying that there could be a recession as early as 2013 if Congress fails to roll back the sequestration cuts that were implemented late last year, and if they allow the Bush-era tax cuts as well as a number of other tax breaks expire January 1st.
Wait a minute. They're saying we'll go back into a recession if we don't continue the tax cuts for the very wealthy and cut programs for the most, for the neediest among us?
Well, I wouldn't go as far as that. I'm saying, you know, if the sequestration does go ahead, that's bad. And also, it's not just the Bush-era tax cuts. And I'm pretty sure the language of it would be flexible to, you know, at least some cuts, or at least letting the expiration happen for the wealthiest Americans. But this is the latest example of politics by brinksmanship, since it doesn't seem like any like there's going to be any movement from Republicans to really accept what Harry Reid right now is saying is a basic step for fiscal stability. You know, this week Harry Reid sent a letter to the congressional Republicans saying that until they are no longer beholden to Tea Party extremism, you know, nothing's really going to be able to move forward. And he called for a balanced approach to rolling back sequestration, which Democrats have been very open to, as well as, you know, letting a number of the tax cuts continue on to the next year, but just not the the crazy version of it that helps the wealthiest among us.
Now, I'm sorry, now who is saying this?
That was Harry Reid.
Ugh, Harry Reid is another one who needs to go. I'm sorry. We need a different majority leader in the Senate. Harry Reid is almost, and I'll say almost, as ineffective as majority leader in the Senate as John Boehner is as Speaker of the House. Harry Reid is horrible. I'm sorry. And what used to make me laugh the most was getting, you know, I'm on his mailing list. So his newsletter would come out with the banner across the top, "Give him hell, Harry." And I thought, Harry who? Because it certainly isn't Harry Reid giving anyone hell.
Well, no, that's true. But, you know, it is a situation like, you know, being the Senate Majority Leader is often described as herding cats.
Yeah.
And unless if you're a big, bombastic personality, it's always a little hard to especially when you have an opposition party that is hellbent.
But Harry Reid is as timid as a mouse. You know, let's get Elizabeth Warren elected to the Senate, Massachusetts, and put someone like her in charge, because we need somebody tough.
Yeah, that's very true. And, you know, Pelosi, for I'm sure you're probably not in favor of everything since she was moderate on a number of issues, but mm-hmm. she was a legislative pile driver. She did not make many friends, but she garnered quite a bit of respect, and she had a list of really impressive achievements, you know, not the least of which is the health care reform law.
Yes. Well, you know what? I think Nancy Pelosi is probably the most progressive Speaker of the House we've ever had. And putting aside her statement from before she even got the gavel saying impeachment is off the table, if you can get that out of the equation, which it's hard to do, I actually like Nancy Pelosi. I think she's tough. I think she got the results she wanted. She was the last one standing fighting for a public option. She really tried. Unfortunately, you know, we had a president who bargained it away in secret. So I actually like Nancy Pelosi. I think she's done a pretty damn good job, you know, relatively speaking, you know, considering who we have.
No, that's fair enough. But I was just trying to say that she certainly has more of the political skill than Harry Reid has.
Yeah, I hear
that's
you.
Just, that's an
I hear
statement.
You. All right. So what else? Now, Congress is in session this week, right?
Yes, they are. And today on the Hill, there is going to be a hearing on the Colombian prostitution scandal with Mark Sullivan, the head of the Secret Service. That's something that's drawing a lot of attention. We're expecting Dianne Feinstein to really go after the particular agents, calling them morally repugnant. And we're going to see what exactly happened and what steps the Secret Service is taking to ensure that this does not happen again. You know, this is going to be interesting. This is a Secret Service agent who has appeared twice on the Hill in recent years for high-level scandals, including the Salahi incident. And there's been very little pushback from lawmakers who, you know, continue to state that they have confidence in him. But today that could be that could be waning a little bit.
Yeah, well, you know, this whole Secret Service thing is really, I'm sorry, tragic, because this is a, it's a horrible distraction, and these people should be above, you know, thinking with their dicks. Sorry, but it's a male issue. You know, I know there were hearings yesterday also about J.P. Morgan. So what happened with that?
I was not covering that as closely. Mm-hmm. I know that was happening at some point. You know, he's still expected to come to the Hill at some point and give a bigger rundown of what happened with the $3 billion losses at this point.
Mm-hmm.
There's also continuing scrutiny over, you know, a role that a JP executive may have had in the Facebook IPO, but that is all slowly coming up.
Yeah, you know, let me ask you that about the Facebook IPO. You know, I think you were an idiot if you spent $38 a share to get in on it. As we've seen, for once I was right. Why is this something the government should be involved in? Shouldn't that be isn't that for the free market?
No, that should be. But there's some talk of investigation of what happened in that initial rollout.
Because God forbid, if rich people lose money on something, then it's a federal case. But, you know, if it affects poor people losing essential services, well, fuck them. They're just lazy. I'm a little pissed. God, I've a whole 180 since this morning. When I started the show really optimistic. But, you know, that all fades away quickly.
Fun times.
Yeah.
But, you know, we're seeing more reports. We're seeing that, you know, there may have been some internal mismanagement of that. There was a decision at some point to increase the shares by about 25% about the day before the initial public offering, and that really killed what a lot of people were expecting, which was a solid rise for the stock.
Wow.
For at least short term.
Oh, well, you gamble and you run the risk of losing. You know, sorry, but, you know, that's just the way it works.
No, I mean, that's why I do not invest. That's why I, you know, I'm kind of a wuss when this happens. You know, we actually had some talk about investing for about one share or two just so we could hopefully afford enough to go out for lunch. But, you know, for some reason, E-Trade seemed to have collapsed on that day.
Okay. Anything else going on today we need to know about?
That seems to be the bulk of it. There's a lot. The Bain controversy continues with the Romney camp now making pretty false allegations, saying that there are about 10 Democrats who are pulling a Cory Booker and siding with Bain on the issue. I've been going through it today, and it looks like a lot of these people are like Governor Ed Rendell and others have, you know, said that Bain is a good company at what it does, but have said that the president's focus is legitimate. That's just some political news there. Last night, we also saw that Obama received about only 58% of the vote from Kentucky Democrats and 60% from Arkansas Democrats. That's, you know, kind of driving a lot of a conversation today, although that's not really a state that they were hoping to be competitive in the first place, considering he lost by about 20 and 16 points in 2008. But that is something that people are talking about just because it's a fun election season stuff until the big news comes in. But that seems to be driving the Hill today, and that's
okay.
What we're looking at.
All right. Justin Duckham from the Talk Radio News Service. Find them always and more at talkradionews.com. Thank you, Justin.
Thank you.
Bye. I'm sorry if you're watching on Ustream and you saw a shocked look of terror on my face. It's because a story just crossed my Twitter stream. I didn't hear about this yesterday. But apparently, yeah, Michael McKean, you know, from Spinal Tap, you know, Michael McKean, David St. Hubbins, was hit by a car yesterday on the Upper West Side of Manhattan. Said he was seen bleeding from the head after a car barreled into him West 86th Street and Broadway just before 3 p.m. yesterday. The actor who was also in Laverne and Shirley, remember he was... I don't know what role, Lenny or Squiggy, one of them, was initially taken to St. Luke's Hospital in critical condition. His status was upgraded to stable condition at the hospital where doctors discovered he had a broken leg. His publicist, Harriet Sternberg, said he'll be okay. Hopefully he'll be fine. It's pretty devastating. And there are pictures of the car and a big trash can and a mailbox were knocked over. I'm stunned. I've known Michael McKean for years. My God, I hope he's okay. that just got me. I'll let you know if I hear anything more. Wow. But they say he was upgraded to, you know, serious condition, out of critical. So, oh, God. Life goes on, you know. Nobody said it would be easy. Okay. At least he's okay. All right. Let's take a break. You know, I wanted to play for you. I watched some of Saturday Night Live yesterday. I didn't see it Saturday. And it was the season finale, actually the end of Saturday Night Live for, what's her name? Kristen Wiig. Is leaving. But the surprising thing to me, Mick Jagger was the host, and he was actually really funny. The pieces that I saw musically, I saw the first, he did a Rolling Stones song with Arcade Fire backing him up that didn't really move me. But there was news made, right? That Mick Jagger did a song called Tea Party in which he cursed. He actually said shit. And many of the affiliates, many of the stations cut away because Mick Jagger said shit at, you know, 12:30 at night. Oh, my God. When are we going to get over this antiquated bullshit about obscenities? Anyway, I thought I'd play the song because it's pretty good. It's called Tea Party. Mick Jagger with Jeff Beck on guitar from Saturday Night Live. And listen to the words.
My roots are in blues music. I love the blues because in any era, the blues talked about what's on people's minds. So here's a blues that I wrote about the presidential election. And here's a man who can really play the blues like nobody else, Jeff Beck.
Wanna sleep in the West Wing? Yeah, you got to strategize a bit. Yeah, you wanna sleep in the West Wing? You wanna keep that private bowling alley? You got to strategize a bit. Yes. Yeah, you're gonna have to raise about $100 million. You're gonna end up so deep down in the shit.
Oh my God, he said shit!
Yeah, Mr. Romney, you know, he's a mensch. But he always plays it straight and fair. Yes, Mr. Romney, he's a hard-working man. And he always says his prayers. Yeah, but there's one little thing about him. Don't ever let him cut your hair. All right. Anybody's guess. That's right. Who be sitting in that Oval Office? Who can say? I must confess. I betcha 6 months he'll be screaming. Why won't you let me out this mess?
Woo! Ah, yes, Mick Jagger and the brilliance of Jeff Beck there. How awesome. was Jeff Beck. Good stuff. All right. We'll take a break and be right back. I'm Nicole Sandler. It's radio or not.
Come experience the next generation of progressive voices. Weekday nights on Nicole Sandler's primetime lineup at radioornot.com. Liberate yourself with filter-free radio, hosted by Jacob Dean every Monday night.
It's just the system is broken. Bring it down. Bring it all down, right?
On Wednesday nights, take a sharp progressive turn and join Talking Left with Danielle and Shano.
All those Republicans are anti-capitalist.
All of a sudden. Well, no, they're just anti-Romney.
Exactly.
and it's interesting to watch the three-legged stool splinter.
Then let it all hang out both Tuesday and Friday nights on Turn Up the Night with Kenny Pick.
You love the Constitution so much, but you hate the government, but you love the corporations. Where does that come from?
Tune in to the primetime Radio or Not lineup weekday nights at the Ustream home of Nicole Sandler, radioornot.com.
I'm sorry, I just find the whole thing so ironic and so mind-bending, it's just ridiculous.
Ever long for the lawlessness of the Old West? Well, now's your chance to rise above the law. For a fistful of only $60, you can incorporate.
I lost my home and my family. I'm gonna kill you.
Sorry, punk. I'm incorporated. Thanks to your apathy, the Fourth Amendment and your civil rights have been abolished. Corporations now have the rights of an individual.
I got you reading my email. For this, you must die.
Excuse me. Invasion of privacy, such as reading private email, tapping someone's phone, grand larceny, false imprisonment, child rape, even murder. You're above it all. If you're incorporated, be unaccountable and incorporate now. Call 1-800. Do you like my new suit and tie? Well, do you, punk?
What is The Boca Show?
I don't know what it is, but it's moving.
Sounds different than you would think. Britt Reed of the Daily Sentinel. Before getting the check, Larry King said,
the worst talk radio I've ever heard in my life.
After getting the check, Larry King says,
that is great radio.
The Boca Show, Sundays at 4 and 7 on 1470 WNN. Archive shows available at thebocashow.com and soflowradio.com. The Boca Show, for when you get bored.
All right. We're going to speak with Russ Baker coming up at the bottom of the hour. But before we get there, I want to try something we tried yesterday. You know, yesterday I tried to call the DNC to talk to them about sending money to Wisconsin. Now, somebody said, you know what? I should have done this during the break. I'm sorry. Did DNC give, hold on, give money to Wisconsin recall? Let's see if I come up with. Well, that's 6 days ago. Let me look under news because a lot of it, 6 days ago, one day, from the Washington Post. Let's see. This is the most recent one I can find from the Washington Post. It says, oh, come on. No, I don't want this ad. Go away, ad. Okay. Yeah, published May 21st. Wisconsin recall leaders struggle to counter Governor Walker's momentum. Amid signs that the effort to oust Republican Governor Scott Walker is losing ground, Wisconsin Democrats and union leaders are preparing a fundraising and get-out-the-vote push to regain momentum in the final weeks before the June recall election. I still don't see anything about, hold on, Axelrod says DNC gave money to recall. Oh, let's see. Nope. Let me try one more news. DNC pushes back. No. I'm not seeing anything. So here, let's do this. Because I can't find anything, let's call the DNC again, shall we? Let me see if I can find where I put that number. Number, here we go. All right. This is the number I called. This is the one I want to call. All right. We're calling the DNC right now because I want to know if they're giving any money. And I guess I could ask for Cheryl Green, who's the person who responded to my email. Yes?
Democratic headquarters.
Hi. May I speak with Cheryl Green, please?
Cheryl Green?
Yes.
Yes, who's calling, please?
My name's Nicole Sandler.
Sandler?
Yes.
Okay. Let me check if she's in her office, okay?
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Yeah, you see, I want to get an answer. I want to find out if the DNC is giving any money to the Wisconsin recall. And if they're not, I know Debbie Wasserman Schultz is going to host a fundraiser. Big fucking deal. If they're
good
not.
Good morning.
Hi.
Hello.
Hi. Cheryl?
Hi.
Hi.
May I help you?
Yes, my name's Nicole Sandler. You responded to an email I sent the other day about the DNC giving money to the Wisconsin recall effort?
This is down in Cheryl's office.
Oh, okay.
This is not Cheryl.
Okay, no problem.
Okay.
I'm just wondering,
alrighty.
Can you tell me...
I'm going to put you on over to her voicemail.
No, can you... Maybe you can answer a question for me. Has the DNC...
Okay, what's the question?
Has the DNC given any money to the Wisconsin recall effort?
Has the DNC given any money to the Wisconsin... I'm not at really liberty to say.
Put
you in the chairman's... Chairman's, I don't know, ma'am.
Wow.
This is the main switchboard, so the calls come through this
I
way.
I see. Okay.
Anybody... So hold on, okay? All right,
okay.
You're welcome.
They're not at liberty to say? I'm telling you, he said it on Matto that we're helping a bit. And then he said, we're giving them $1 million.
You have reached the voicemail box of Cheryl Green with the chairman's office. Please leave your name, number, and a brief message, I'll return your call as soon as possible. Thank you.
Okay.
At the tone, please record your message. When you are finished recording, hang up or press pound for more options.
Hi. Hi, Cheryl. My name's Nicole Sandler. You responded to an email I sent yesterday about the DNC not giving any money to the Wisconsin recall effort. And what she said in the email was that, that Debbie Wasserman Schultz will host a fundraiser for Mayor Barrett later this month. And the DNC will utilize both its substantial network of activists, volunteers, and supporters and extensive online resources to assist in building the ground game that will win on Election Day. Excuse me. You didn't say anything about giving money. Mayor Barrett needs, what the Wisconsin Democrats need is money from the Democratic National Committee. What I want to know is...
10 seconds remain. Please conclude your message.
What I want to know is if the DNC is giving any money, actual hard cash. If not, I will no longer be registered as a Democrat. My email is nicole@nicolesandler.com.
To send, press 1. To replay, press 2.
All
to
right.
erase
well,
and
we'll
re-record,
just
press 3.
It. Press 1.
To send now, press 1. To mark the message sent. To disconnect, press 1. To enter another number, goodbye.
Goodbye. All right. This is really pissing me off. All right. Matto has anything about a David. That's the wrong one. Matto.msnbc.com. Is there anything on Morning Matto? Did David Axelrod say anything? Here we go. On it doesn't. This
high
is going to be an ad. I don't want to hear their ad. That's a 30-second ad. Shoot. Sorry about this. I'm just loading it again to see what the David Axelrod on the challenge of countering Republican narrative. That's not the interview I want to see. I want to know. And it doesn't look like it's on here. Latest program. Yeah, that's the only David Axelrod clip they have. Yeah. I'm going to get to the bottom of this, but not right now because, we have a guest to get on. So let's take a time out. We'll listen to the Green News and come back with Russ Baker next. All right. Right here at radio. Or not.
I have no intention to resign.
That was then. This week, Republicans collect another Obama administration scalp. More bad news for climate change denying Heartland Institute. Robot fish. Yep, robot fish. Plus,
the people here chose to define the tragedy not by what happened to us, but by how we responded.
Remembering Joplin and the ongoing toll of extreme weather disasters.
All of that and more straight ahead from bradblog.com. I'm Brad Friedman.
And I'm Desi Doyen.
Stand by for 6 minutes of independent green news, politics, analysis, and snarky comment.
It's Arizona. Nothing wrong with that state that a
crippled Japanese nuclear plant couldn't solve. But,
You said it, Bill Maher, not me. This is your Green News Report. Okay, Des, I would ask how your cold is doing, but we've got a big Green News Report here today, so I don't care how your cold is doing. Just get on with the news.
Oh, well, thanks anyway.
You're welcome.
It's a sobering anniversary marking the toll of extreme weather disasters.
Just hours after the class of 2011 walked across this stage, the most powerful tornado in six decades tore a path of devastation through Joplin that was nearly a mile wide and 13 long.
In an inspirational high school commencement ceremony in Joplin, Missouri on Tuesday, President Obama remembered the 161 people killed in last year's record tornado outbreak and how that community has pulled together to rebuild. The rare and deadly F5 tornado, the highest on the scale, hit exactly 1 year ago Tuesday, part of a record outbreak of tornadoes in a year of record extreme weather disasters. 2011 smashed all records for the highest number of billion-dollar extreme weather disasters in a single year. The record floods on the Mississippi River, Hurricane Irene, record heat waves, drought, and wildfires in Texas and the Southwest, and the Joplin tornado may be the reason that finally polls show a majority of Americans now making the connection between global warming and the rise in extreme weather disasters, just as climate scientists have been predicting for years.
Well, that took long enough, didn't it?
Unfortunately, yes. But don't tell that to the climate change deniers at the Heartland Institute's Climate Change Denial Conference in Chicago this week. Heartland's corporate donors and staff are dumping them in droves after their ill-advised billboard campaign comparing the vast majority of scientists and Americans to serial killer Ted Kaczynski for accepting the scientific consensus on climate change.
That's what these guys do. That's how desperate these guys are. And I guess it's now beginning to cost them?
It is. Heartland admits to losing nearly $1 million in funding so far. Oh, but don't worry about poor Heartland Institute. ExxonMobil and lobbyists for Big Coal have stepped in to donate funds for their deniers conference.
So the fossil fuel industry to the rescue of the climate change deniers. Who could have foreseen that?
In other bad news for Heartland Institute, the climate expert who admitted tricking the Institute into giving him internal strategy and propaganda documents last February has been cleared of faking those documents. Peter Gleick, a climate expert who exposed Heartland's climate denier propaganda strategy, has been cleared of forging any and all documents after an independent external investigation conducted by his employer, the nonprofit Pacific Institute.
Very interesting, given the plot that was exposed last year, where a plan was being developed for the U.S. Chamber of Commerce and the Bank of America to release forged documents to folks like myself and Glenn Greenwald, and then come out and claim that we were the forgers. This Heartland Institute scheme seems to have worked in almost exactly the same way.
And don't forget, Heartland had a plan to teach U.S. kids climate denial and anti-evolution propaganda in the U.S. science curriculum.
Yes, that was one of the things that was exposed by Gleick.
We've got people who are suffering under this gentleman right here.
Would you consider stepping down as chairman?
I have no intention to resign.
That was Chairman of the Nuclear Regulatory Commission, Gregory Yatsko, defending himself in a hearing last November against congressional Republicans who attacked him for his personnel management style. Yatsko announced on Monday that he will indeed step down from the NRC after all, as soon as his successor can be confirmed by Congress. Since being elevated to the chairmanship by President Obama, Yatsko has clashed repeatedly with Republicans, his fellow commissioners, and the nuclear energy industry, especially after he imposed new, tougher safety requirements for U.S. nuclear plants in the wake of the Fukushima nuclear disaster.
And if I'm not mistaken, Yatsko was the only one of the commissioners to vote against the two new nuclear plants that the Obama administration has approved.
That's correct. Finally, no, it's not Bruce the mechanical shark from Jaws, but it is a robot fish, a new mechanical underwater robot that looks like a 5-foot-long neon yellow fish with fins. This robot fish is now being tested in a harbor in Spain. It has onboard sensors that can immediately detect illegal pollution discharges in the water and alert regulators, far faster than the current system that relies on divers and labs that take weeks to return results.
Wow. So we're going to have an army of robot fish that swim around and alert authorities to pollution?
Yes.
Cool. But of course, there is the danger no one's talking about, that of an army of robot fish rising up against us. For more on that story and all the others we couldn't get to today, please check out our website at greennews.bradblog.com. While you're there, please consider a donation to help sponsor the Green News Report.
We rely on you, at least until we get our own army of robot fish. From BradBlog.com, I'm Brad Friedman.
And I'm Desi Doyen.
And this has been your Green News Report.
What we are dealing with here is a perfect engine, an eating machine.
Bad fish, but I'll catch him and kill him.
You're going to need a bigger boat.
The George Rodriguez Show.
Who?
I said the George Rodriguez Show. You don't know George Rodriguez?
Wasn't he the guy that filled in for Neil Rogers?
Yes. That George Rodriguez.
What's he like?
Oh, he's a short little Cuban fella. Kind of funny looking.
Well, when's he on?
12 to 3, Monday, Wednesday, and Friday on SoFloRadio.com and SoFloRadio.net. The George Rodriguez Show. He's much more than
adequate.
Hi, friends. This is Tom Hartman.
This is Stephanie Miller.
Hey, this is Hal Sparks.
I'm Brad Friedman. I approve of Nicole Sandler's RadioOrNot.com.
Radio or not.
Radio or not.
Radio or not.com.
Radio or not.com.
Radio or not.com.
Radio or not.com.
And that's where we are. Radio or not. .com. I'm Nicole Sandler. Let's get Russ Baker on the line, shall we? You know, I constantly sing the praises of real investigative journalism. It's sort of a dying breed. Of course, our pal Greg Palast does it. Our Jason Leopold, our friends at Truth Out, do it. And Russ Baker and his people at whowhatwhy.com do it. And by that, I'm talking about real investigative journalism. Hi, Russ Baker.
Hello, Nicole Sandler.
How are you this morning?
Just doing great.
Good. Good. I'm glad. I sound like it sounds like I woke you or something, no?
Oh, you woke me in the middle of a thought.
Ah, well, those are always those are not good times to interrupt. A thought about anything you want to share?
Well, you know, it's so frustrating for me because I see stories like every 5 minutes that are not being covered properly, and it just drives me nuts. You know, I look and I say, "Oh my God, that's not the real story. Oh my God, that's not the real story. Oh my God," you know. And I just, you know, I just wish I had the resources and the team to get on all of these.
Don't we all? yeah, it's really stunning. I mean, I was talking about this in the last hour with Jesse LaGreca about the fact that our corporate media, first of all, that our government just approved the use of government propaganda, of lying to the American people in the NDAA. And it's stunning when we're fighting for real, you know, a return to real journalism, which is really sort of a dying breed these days.
Well, do you remember this guy, Cass Sunstein, the information czar, or the open government czar, they call him, which is a total misnomer. And he, you know, Obama had offered him a very high level, very visible position.
Yeah.
And instead, he took this thing, which doesn't get much attention. But years ago, he had actually written a paper encouraging the government to surreptitiously put agents into the internet to tamp down conspiracy theories.
Oh my God. Wow.
Yeah, you know,
wow.
So I mean, these people have a very, very strong, I mean, I understand that the internet is, you know, as Schmidt, the former CEO of Google, calls it, a bit of a cesspool in terms of the, there's so much junk and so much rumor and unverified stuff, but at the same time, people will figure out for themselves what are the trusted brands. But to go in there and tamp down, you know, legitimate discussion,
wow,
about things where we need answers, I mean, that's pretty remarkable.
It really is remarkable. I mean, one thing we're talking about this morning, and I can't get a straight answer on it because I know what the answer is, the fact that the DNC has not given any money to the Wisconsin recall effort is pretty mind-boggling. And you know what? There's nothing been written about it recently. I mean, about a week ago, it got a little bit of a press from The Nation and a few other places. I sent an email yesterday when I couldn't get through by phone and got the most roundabout bullshit response from someone at the DNC talking about that Debbie Wasserman Schultz is going to go to Wisconsin, quote, later this month. And the DNC will utilize both its substantial network of activists, volunteers, and supporters and extensive online resources to assist in building the ground game that will win on Election Day, is the exact quote. But no money. And it's, you know, wow, this is, I'm just stunned by this. And the fact that it's not gaining any traction anywhere in the legitimate media, why would the DNC be staying away from there in terms of giving money?
I don't know, but see, you just added another one to my list of things that I'm frustrated that we can't get to. You know, I mean, there's a good journalist can resolve that. And there's, you know, my guess is it's going to be something like, for some technical reason, their legal people don't want them to do it.
Yeah, right.
It could be turned around and used to make them look bad. They don't want to be accused of directly meddling in a state level.
Well, give me a break. All you have to do is look at the RNC. Well, actually, they probably don't need the RNC money because they've got the Koch brothers and they've got all these, you know, big money
interests. Exactly. But you see, that's what it would be that somebody said, you know what, the RNC stays out of these things, stays above the fray, and we don't want to be exposed. It's going to be something like that.
Yep. Yeah. And so there's that. But I want to, you know, your latest piece, one that you published yesterday at whowhatwhy.com, Burying the Lockerbie Bomber and the Truth. And, you know, we all heard the story of the guy who, you know, got released 3 years ago on humanitarian reasons because, you know, he was supposedly dying within a few months, now lived 3 years. Now you're saying, wait a minute, do we even know the whole story? Is this guy the one responsible for bringing down that plane, that Pan Am 103? And you're saying that maybe not?
Right, and last year when we were leading the way in questioning the real reasons that the United States and its allies were going after Gaddafi, we pointed out that there had been a long-term effort to vilify him in the minds of people in the West to support these kinds of actions, and that all the indications were that the main thing about Gaddafi was not that he was sponsoring terrorism, but that he was fiercely independent, that he was a regional leader that went his own way, and that this was very, very unacceptable. And there's been a pattern of that, of course, all over the world. But as far as Lockerbie, that was the thing, more than anything else, that was hung around his neck and that basically hobbled him. In other words, if he was going to become a kind of a regional player like a Castro or a Chavez or whoever, this was the thing that very effectively blocked him. And Libya was so cut off from the whole world because of the sanctions, they got desperate. And so they agreed to pay billions of dollars in reparations, although they denied. They said, we didn't have anything to do with this, but we're only paying so that we won't be cut off by these people from the rest of the world. And that's very, very important. Now, at that time, I started looking back at the Lockerbie story, something I had not investigated on my own, and I saw all these anomalies, and I saw how many distinguished people had said that they had grave doubts about the whole thing. And now, with this current piece on Who, What, Why, what we point out is that the New York Times itself, which rarely gets to the bottom of these things, doesn't even try. One decent guy on the paper, a rewrite man in his 70s, tried to tip us off to what was really going on. And I quote his piece where he says he lists all these irregularities, suggesting that maybe this guy, Megrahi, did not do the bombing, maybe Libya was not involved. And immediately the next day, the Times is out really quick with a couple of other pieces, basically debunking their own guy.
Wow. So who, I mean, now you're saying, Russ Baker, that there are serious doubts as to whether or not this guy was actually responsible or you know,
whether Libya was.
Or whether Libya was behind it. So who pushed this story?
Well, you see, this is this giant, you know, disinformation apparatus. And it's, you know, it's the CIA and it's the Pentagon and it's all of that. And journalists are always in a tough position because, as a rule, none of us want to be made to look ridiculous. None of us want to be laughingstocks. None of us want to be told you are no longer invited to sit at the feast.
Uh-huh.
And so, you know, we can never, and this is a rule, this is an unspoken rule in journalism, never, never, never question what your country does when it would be something so bad that it would be equivalent to what we say other countries do. So,
right.
In other words, we're perfectly happy to say, without really very good evidence, and, you know, even the judge and everybody else in that case said that it was all very circumstantial whether Libya had anything to do, you know, we're perfectly happy to say this creep, Gaddafi, deserves to die because he was responsible for killing all these people on the plane, but we would never entertain the possibility that anybody from our country would have the same instincts to bomb a plane when there was some kind of an agenda behind it. And we know from from the Kennedy administration, where the Joint Chiefs of Staff went to Kennedy and proposed that the United States secretly be behind a bombing campaign in the United States against its own people and blame it on Cuba. So we know that there are people in this country who would do things like that.
Right. And Russ Baker, to take it even a step further, the fact that, you know, I did mean to get to it. You know, we haven't also, and this, here's another story that the corporate media hasn't reported on. The fact that Chris Hedges, Noam Chomsky, Daniel Ellsberg, and four others filed a lawsuit against the indefinite detention provision in the National Defense Authorization Act, and a federal judge actually ruled in their favor. There's a stay on that provision, in effect, by a federal judge. And if you didn't, you know, if I didn't read alternative news sources, I would never know that was the case.
Right. And so the question would be, why is that not a big headline?
That should be a huge headline. And in fact, you know, back in the days when this version of the NDAA was first introduced, and people like me, I know I'm one of those who raised huge red flags about that provision, and Obama bots, and I'll call them that in this case, derided me as an emo prog or a firebagger because I dared question something that the president, at least by some measure, was supporting.
Right. Right. And so in a situation like that, couple of things. First of all, the media is acting as gatekeepers.
Yeah.
And they're saying, nah, you know what, let's not tell this story. Let's not play this thing big. The decisions that are made in those morning conferences in the newsrooms are tremendously important. And, you know, the thing is that it's not even so much a conscious thing. It's not that somebody in the newsroom is overtly thinking or saying, look, this is a really big story, let's kill it so nobody knows about it. What they're doing is they've kind of convinced themselves, you know, this is sort of grandstanding by people who like publicity, and so forth, as if, you know, what the president does every day isn't grandstanding by somebody who likes publicity, you know. So there's a total double standard on this stuff.
It really is. And look, unless you read Chris Hedges' account of it at truthdig.org or read Glenn Greenwald at Salon, you wouldn't know that this is huge, right?
Yeah. It is. And I'll tell you, there's another problem, too, which is that even within this kind of media or media sphere of both journalism and opinion that you're pointing out, pick these stories up, there's very little cooperation among them. And I'll just tell you, some of the names you mentioned, we send them our stories, mm-hmm. and they never mention them.
Wow.
Because they didn't do them themselves.
Right.
You see,
right.
This is a defect of the whole progressive sphere. When you talk to conservatives and you talk to Republicans, they're even though they fight with each other, they're also much, much better at burying the hatchet and working together toward common ends. They sit down and they say, all right, let me write a check. What is, you know, who's doing what? What does this take? I would actually say this is sort of a fatal flaw of liberal leftists that there's some psychological issue, some ego thing, which I think is actually worse on that end of the spectrum, and it's so bad that it overrides the ability to get anything done.
Well, I hear you, and it's a shame. It's like what I was talking with, again, Jesse LaGreca about, the fact that, you know, in order for the Occupy movement to succeed, it needs to encompass, you know, the big tent theory. When I was at a you know, an event in D.C. in December, there were people from Occupy D.C. at McPherson Square who were, like, battling against the union. You're not really part of us. You're union. You know what? You have to understand that if we're on the same side, we're on the same side. And the same goes for those people who want to call me names because I dare criticize some of the policies of this administration. Russ Baker is with us from whowhatwhy.com, a great site that does independent, original investigative pieces. You know, another story that you wrote about from last week, titled "Something Stinks: John Edwards in a 30-year jail term." And I got, you know, I'm a little surprised and pleasantly so that there hasn't been more of a media circus around this. And maybe I'm just not paying attention. But you're right. You start the piece asking the question, does it seem a little bit odd that John Edwards is facing a potential 30-year jail term? Yes.
I would argue that actually the lack of a media circus is in itself almost sinister. And here's why. If there was a media circus, they would be forced to actually tell the public what's going on with that trial. And they would have to tell them things like, you know, the prosecution doesn't want this Riel Hunter to testify because she's so unreliable. Like, the defense makes a lot of really legitimate points, like, as I mentioned in this article on Who, What, Why, there's this... you know, this is all about the Federal Election Commission. It's a technical issue that it's not that Edwards took this money from these people to help basically pay off this mistress so she wouldn't go public and destroy him. Which, you know, you can do that. You can pay people to
give them,
you know,
money to do whatever they want with it.
Yeah,
right?
You can do whatever you want. Now, so the issue was not that. It was a technical issue that they're saying this was a campaign contribution, and therefore it should have been reported and it should have been subject to limits. And so this gets into a question of, is this a campaign contribution or is this not? Now, a former Federal Election Commission commissioner of long standing, who had spent, I believe, 30-some years working for the FEC, a well-respected guy, he came in to testify to say, you know what, I don't think this would be something that would fall under our purview. Huh. And they looks like they will not even allow the jury to hear from him. He had to testify without the jury in the room. I mean, this is astonishing to me. And so, you know, you've got to look at all this stuff. You've got to look at, like, why are they prosecuting him? Why, you know, they didn't have to. Somebody high up in the administration decided to go after him. Now, of course, Edwards was a competitor to Obama. I'm not saying that's how this works, but I mean, somebody made some decision that this was a priority to put millions of dollars of public. That'd be another issue: is what is this costing the taxpayer? You know, I didn't even mention that in the article, but should have. What is it costing the taxpayer to go after this guy?
You know what? Whose life is already really destroyed. I mean, look, the thing is, this guy, his life is destroyed. His reputation is shot. He wanted to, and he could have been president of the United States, and now his name is dirt. He's lost his wife. He's, you know, his kids are the ones who are going to suffer the most, his young kids. And, like, leave the man alone already. Just, you know, make him live his life doing public, you know, defense or something. Yeah, but
well,
this is nonsense.
The point that I make on Who, What, Why is that there's more to this article, Nicole. There's more to this
story
issue,
yeah?
This story, than destroying him. In other words, if you look at the pattern of politicians who have been destroyed in sex scandals, it is disproportionate against Democrats and particularly liberal left politicians with a populist, an outspoken populist, us versus them bent. And that is the kind of thing that sends chills up my spine, because if you look at it, there were just as many Republicans and conservatives, and even those are more interesting stories because those people were running on, like, you know, family values and questioning other people's, you know, morality and religiosity and all of this kind of stuff. You know, those are the people who are very much against, you know, a sex education and condom distribution, all these things. Those are the stories that from a news standpoint make more sense. And yet what we see is we see the prosecution or other kind of hassling by the media and by prosecutors of, you know, Gary Hart and Spitzer
and on
all of these people. And in this article, I list these people, and you can see, and as an investigative reporter, I've been looking at some of these things, and they look suspicious to me. They actually look like these people were set up. And you know, some folks will say, well, hold on a second. Come on. They wanted to do this. I'm not saying they didn't want to do it. That's how you set somebody up.
Exactly. And, you know,
they don't set them up for something they don't
want. No, right. Russ Baker. So while we were talking, David, my fiance, just walked in the room and put a note in front of me, as he often does during the show. And he said, Family of Secrets, still the scariest book ever. As I hold up my big copy of it, Family of Secrets, the Bush dynasty, the powerful forces that put it in the White House, and what their influence means for America. In fact, Russ, this is how I met you, because our mutual friend Howie Klein said, you got to talk to this guy, Russ Baker, about this book. And here we are, and for some reason Jeb Bush is being touted as like the next coming of the GOP, and that's because this country does not know what's in this book, does not know what the Bush family is all about.
Well, right, and actually yesterday I was having lunch with somebody. He was saying, what your body of work and Family of Secrets, and also on Who, What, Why, is really about a whole other layer of American power that is not understood. And it really, you know, the triumph of the Bush family and their continuing influence is that they are operatives on behalf of really, I think, more calculating and more sinister, certainly more powerful and wealthier elements in our society, rich people, rich families, corporations, that really are you know, they're you know, if ice water running through their veins, mm-hmm. they will do anything to maintain their power. And when they are a very, very small subset of the populace in a purported democracy, they have to pull off covert operations against an Edwards, against a Hart, against you know, maybe look, I'm not saying it's the case, but if you look at these plane crashes, they're disproportionately people who are making trouble.
Paul Wellstone, hello, you know, and look, I'm among the many who believe that Paul Wellstone was targeted. He was too much of a rising progressive star.
You know, how about Hale Boggs, who was the only person from the Warren Commission who began to be outspoken saying that he thought that the fix was in on the Kennedy assassination.
Right.
He disappeared over Alaska. The
wow.
History Channel, which is not what you would call a radical outlet, it's owned by big companies, but they've done a thing now saying that they think that Hale Boggs' plane was fixed.
Wow. Wow.
I mean, this is what they do. You know, people go, oh, come on. And the reason they go, oh, come on, is because they don't want to hear about this.
Right.
Listen,
you don't
want to
think about it.
What do you think covert operatives and intelligence agencies do? I mean, do you think that they're distributing, you know, free lunches? I mean,
mm-hmm.
what do you think those people do for a living? I mean, what do you think special ops and special forces people do? They are trained to kill people. They are trained to do things secretly and never talk about them. And they are trained not to ask any questions. The Americans are the most naive people in the world. I travel everywhere, and everywhere else I go, people go, absolutely, of course. I'm talking about big people, elected officials, publishers, you know, in these other countries. Bankers tell me, yeah, of course our president was assassinated by the security service. They have no question about that this is the norm. In this country, you talk about this, and you're instantly persona non grata.
Right. Right. No, you're blackballed. You're ignored. Now, so let's talk for one second, if you don't mind, about Jeb Bush. Why all of a sudden is he being here's a guy who, you know, left his job. He was the governor of Florida quietly. I will give it that he's a bit smarter than his younger brother, George. But like, why all of a sudden is he the shining star there? Why?
Well, you see, the Bush family had made a decision going back several generations ago that they were going to get into politics. They were going to be the family that
George
did the bidding of the bankers, and they were going to do it consistently. And this is a scary development because others come and go, you know, one person from a family, and then that's it. But then the Bush family, they've decided that they're just going to keep on doing this forever. And so you know, you had George, totally improbable for the presidency. His father, as you know, in my book, Family of Secrets, I have half the books about the father and his secret life in covert stuff. The father really was not appropriate for the presidency. The son was not appropriate. Now there's a Jeb who seems better than either of the others, a better speaker, maybe more intelligent, more capable. But basically, working off of the same playbook, and so he's the next guy. And then they got others from the next generation that they're already ginning up to run for office. Jeb, I think, is a very serious contender, and I wonder about those two secret private meetings that Poppy Bush and Jeb had with Obama. You know, what were they talking about? You know, I think there are understandings among these people. Why did Poppy Bush and Bill Clinton become such great friends?
Yes, you know, good question. Oh, they're still great friends. I'm actually,
yeah.
One of the many books I'm reading at the moment is The President's Club. And yeah, I mean, Bill Clinton and Poppy Bush are like bosom buddies. It's
yeah.
Kind of freaky. And this brings to mind another story, not written by you, but Spencer Mandel, that you can read on whowhatwhy.com. I spy in Occupy. Obama's DHS surveils legit protesters, and we are seeing that the First Amendment has been all but, you know, stricken from the Constitution. I mean, it doesn't exist anymore.
Yeah, you know, and I mean, the interesting thing here is that, you know, if the Department of Homeland Security actually thinks that the Occupy movement is some kind of a terrorist threat, because, I mean, their mandate is, that's what their mandate is,
to
secure the homeland, not to secure Bank of America.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, if they think that that's a legitimate thing, then let them say that, and let Obama say that, and let them be open about it, not what Spencer describes in here as basically, you know, this kind of sneaky effort, you know, sub rosa to coordinate with all these police departments and mayor's offices. You know, I mean, what are they doing there? They're, you know, I think what they do on some levels, they convince themselves that they're worried that this could create some kind of gridlock for the country, and, you know, everything would grind down, and that loosely defined is Homeland Security. But if this is a democracy, let us decide.
Exactly.
Let us decide whether that's a problem or whether we can put up with the inconvenience of some traffic jams and things like that. Because what more problem are we facing than that?
Gee, I don't know. Russ Baker, will I see you in Providence this year? I know we first met in person, I think, last year or the year before at Netroots Nation.
You know, I don't think I'm going to get out there this year. I you know, these kind of entities, I'll be blunt about it, I mean, they're not really my cup of tea, and I've got to use my time to do the journalism we're doing. We're trying to build up Who, What, Why as a you know, nonprofit, and as a kind of a movement for a better information source for America and for the world. That's really where I want to be putting
My
time.
Gotcha. Time and resources and money. So in fact, they run off of your donations. The website whowhatwhy.com. Russ Baker, always a pleasure to talk with you, and I love reading what you put on here, because again, it's the stuff you're not going to find from the corporate media. It doesn't exist in their world. There, I believe there's an agenda. The agenda comes from the corporate owners of whatever the media outlet is, and that doesn't exist at whowhatwhy.com. So always a pleasure, Russ. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Take care. Bye-bye. All right, and that's going to about do it for us for today. Tomorrow, we wrap up our week here. Of course, John Fugelsang will be here, and one more time, I cannot say enough how brilliant Guilt of Love Story was. I know it's not, you know, touring wildly around the nation, but when it does come to your town, if it does, go see it. It's John Fugelsang at his best. It's just awesome. So I'll heap some praise on him tomorrow. We'll get some laughs with him, and you know, we'll see what else is going on between now and then. Again, thank you for the support, for listening, for watching, for sharing. We'll do it tomorrow, radio or not. Thanks, everyone.